I'm very happy to welcome Mr. Bhupendra Singh, co-founder and director, I2TB Research Foundation, Gurgaon, Haryana, India, to present his session lecture on Anywhere, Anytime, AI, IoT, and Blockchain. Mr. Bhupendra Singh is the co-founder and director of I2TB Research Foundation at Gurgaon, Haryana, India. He received his B.Tech in Electronics and Communication from NIT Kurukshetra in 1985. And M.Tech in Computer Science from Institute of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineers, New Delhi in 1994. He has an overall experience of more than 35 years in various industries, technologies, academy, and entrepreneurship. He had served in public sector units in India like Bell and ECIL, involving in the R&D activities. He has devised the technology roadmap for telecom and defense product definition, leading to system architecture design. He was head of project deliveries at Arikant and Hughes Software, involving projects on wireless mobile call control, video conferencing, etc. He was guest faculty at BITS Pilani for M.Tech Data Science program during 2019-20. He was a faculty for conducting CEP programs for engineering college faculties at IIT Delhi for Big Data in 2015 and evaluation of M.Tech, CS and EC thesis at IIT Delhi in 2010. He was visiting faculty for system software at IMS Ghaziabad in 1994. Since 2012, he has been mentoring startups mainly in innovation for technology and business, focusing on telecom, mobile, cloud computing, big data, etc. He has three startups to its credit: I2TB in the area of technology incubation and acceleration, Apurva Career Academy aimed at guiding the aspiring students towards competitive and careers preparation, and PropTech involving in B2B portals for real estate business. His area of current research areas are in cloud computing, big data, etc. As I discussed earlier, I have great pleasure in welcoming Mr. Bhupendra Singh, a tech entrepreneur. I welcome you, sir. Please take over.
First of all, let me thank iManager for giving me this opportunity to present my talk, especially to Rajkumar and Madam Ranisha. And I also very delighted to have a better understanding of two earlier my speakers who have enlightened me on two very new technology where I have no exposure so far. So I enjoy the talk. So now I will continue with my session. And my session is little different than the past two, because two are very specific in the area of power electronics and other was into antenna. So my talk is into more related to interdisciplinary area, which is a combination of computer science, electronics, especially. Okay, so that's why AI, IoT, and blockchain together, how they empower the future electronic devices, right? So that's why it fits the topic of the seminar, loading intelligence into the future electronic devices. So agenda of my talk is around, first of all, I'll give some background and introduction to the all the three component, which is artificial intelligence, IoT, and blockchain. And these three technology, how they are impacting every aspect of life, and they are available everywhere, anywhere. Then I will move on to what these three building blocks are about, basically AI, then IoT, blockchain. And obviously they are powerful and useful convergence, which make their potential use in various domains. Obviously, I will touch upon towards the end what are the various challenges being faced currently and limitations and how way forward. So just to quickly to give you the background, as all of you will agree, the digital information technology have changed in general, but I will talk about only AI and IoT blockchain in particular, which has transformed our life in all the aspects, impacting positively. It has changed the way we live, we learn, we entertain, we socialize ourselves, run the business, including managing cities and government. So these three building blocks, which we'll discuss throughout my presentation, AI, IoT, and blockchain, how they combined make it so powerful, so that the combination become very, very potential. Okay. This is what is the topic of the conference. So how this is possible, there are many, background to it. First of all, the computing machines have tremendously grown in powers, and every time, every year, it is going exponentially, right? The few things which I like to mention here is cloud computing and 5G in the form of faster communication, more processing power at very commodity prices through cloud computing made it possible to run these artificial intelligence based or IoT based solution as a reality. So before I go to the detail into this, let me set what is the artificial intelligence formally talk about. So basically, it is a science and engineering making intelligent machine, especially with the help of computer-based systems. So this is how it's been defined by father of AI, and it is nothing but making either a pure software-based system or a computer-controlled system or a robotic, or in any way, all the three can be made intelligent using artificial intelligence. When I say intelligent, means it can behave like a human. How this is basically accomplished, AI is accomplished. First of all, all the researchers have understood how the human brain works, learns, and decide to do a solution. And using these concepts, they are then being translated into intelligent software and systems. So now, what is this term anywhere for everywhere for us? That means when I say everywhere, anywhere, it is impacting, all aspects of our life. And not only this, it also available across the geographical reach, whether it is at the ground, whether it is under sea or in the airborne or space, like satellite, drones, self-driving cars. All these are plenty of examples which demonstrate AI and IoT, and especially having blockchain as well. They are available everywhere across the various industries and use cases. When I say time, any time dimension for me is AI-based system can work all the time across the different time zone without being bored, tired, showing any emotions, and it also does not show any bias towards the some actions they do. They don't differentiate. So that is my definition of anytime, anywhere. So now I'll move on to how this technology are currently trending. So if you see this graph which I have taken from some of the research company, so they are all showing AI ML is heavily investing, you can say, a topic, and then followed by IoT and blockchain. You can see six almost 67% IoT, 60% AI ML, and 30% within that is in edge computing. So this edge computing is a right now edge is a very buzzword. Edge computing for me is a device which are towards the last leg of network. And these are the devices which are typically in the remote areas or in the end, not in the cloud, which is the background or main, or you can say main system. So before we move on to AI, we need to understand what is the intelligence is all about. So I have just taken this information from which typically define intelligence. So intelligence typically in term of human intelligence, it is human intelligence can do calculate, they can do reasoning, they can perceive, they can learn from the experience, they can store and retrieve information, solve the problems, and they can use language very frequently. So these are the some of the intelligence which are is present in all human beings, and at the same time we expect these intelligence to be available in the system designed by human beings. Typically when I say it is computer-based system. So I'm just skipping, these are some type of intelligence which are available in case of human: linguistic intelligence, musical intelligence, then logical mathematics, then we have a spatial intelligence, then we have motor skill. All these we are using in our day-to-day life. These are two intelligence which are only applicable for the people, that intrapersonal and interpersonal. So these are very useful intelligence which are available with the human, and they are using this to solve a lot of problems. So our intent or our motivation is to implement all these kind of intelligence component into systems design, especially using computers in particular. So when I say what are these components: reasoning, learning, perception, problem solving, linguistic. These five components, anyone or all combination, if they can be implemented into any computer-based systems, then those systems can be qualified, can be attributed, they are intelligent system. So for the time saving, I'm not going into it. Like reasoning are typically of two types, inductive and deductive. In inductive, we make a inference from specific observation to a journal, and in deductive we do the other way around. From journal we make a very specific conclusions. Similarly, learning is an ability which can make behavior adaptive based upon our environment or past state. We can change our behavior. And in human, we have multiple, learning type, and all these learning type typically based upon some perception or some senses. Like human being have auditory learning, which we do by listening and hearing. We also have a motor learning by which we learn how to move, how to run. We have the visual or observation learning based upon our vision, perception. Similarly, we have also ability to do with respect to image, color, maps, which is called spatial learning. So these kind of learning are very natural to human being. Similarly, the intelligent behavior shown by a human also used for problem solving. Problem solving nothing but working out a desired solution from the present situation. So in human, perception is aided by sensory organs, and its equivalent in AI, data is acquired by the sensors and then put together in meaningful way. So that's what it is being translated from human being to the machines. Now, the difference between how the human and machine do, they typically are different. Human perceive by pattern, while machine perceive by the set rules and data, which is defined by, again, its designer. Humans store and recall information by pattern, while machine do it by searching the data available through searching algorithms. Human can figure out the object even if something is missing or distorted, where in case of machine, they cannot do it correctly. So hence, human can deal with the ambiguity while machines cannot. So when we are designing intelligent system, we need to take care of these aspects of the machine's limit. You can say aspects and limitation. So quickly, now if I summarize, we can say any machine or a system which is artificially intelligent when it is equipped at least one or more of these five intelligent components. Now if I go to how the artificial intelligence is deployed. So we have here a couple of, you can say, subtype in the artificial domain. So first off is called machine learning. And machine learning is then deep learning. Then we have a robotics. We also have a vision, data mining, chatbot, expert system. All these are sub-branch of artificial intelligence. And they take care of some parts. Some are overlapping. They, any one of can do similar kind of job. So let us begin with quickly to look at what is this expert system is. The expert systems typically emulate the expert behavior of human being. Like in case of flight tracking systems, they can guide aircraft like a human controller does. Similarly, in medical systems, they behave like a very expert medical clinician. And natural language processing, nowadays we know a lot of device can recognize the speech. They can translate. Similarly, neural network is a kind of artificial intelligence technique which can help mostly to recognize patterns such as face, handwriting, including face and other vision systems. Robotic is basically a mechanical device along with a computing system which imitate the structure as well as functionality as humans. And they are being used in the industry as well as in healthcare, in home care. And they have, again, an intelligent system using AI. Last but not least, fuzzy logic system classify into intelligence because they are very similar to human being in handling the imprecise information. I told you, human being can deal with the imprecise or ambiguity. So fuzzy logic system are designed to take care of where the situations are not so yes or no type, where the input is not so precise. So logic this fuzzy logic system deals with that kind of situation. They are useful mainly in consumer devices, automobiles, they find applications. So that's why they are figuring out at artificial intelligence. Data mining is another technique within AI, which basically allow to find out any hidden patterns, hidden inference and knowledge from the vast amount of data, whether it's a corporate data, whether it's a internet itself, like a web crawler, can crawl multiple sites going through unlimited amount of data. Right? Machine learning is a technique by where first machine is to be trained with the help of known input as well as output. Once this is being trained, they are capable of, you know, then classifying, clustering, and even predicting based upon the training. So they have two kind of variant here, rather three kind of variant. One is supervised machine learning, where, as told, it is being trained under well-known training data. Unsupervised, we don't have any known output. The system itself take care, and the reinforcement is in between. They start with unsupervised behavior, and based upon their outcome, they are being either negatively enforced or positively enforced. So that is the way this machine learning works. Then we have a vision, which is a very special subtopic of artificial intelligence, which make the intelligent system to recognize various objects, whether face, whether handwritten, or image or video. The last two subtopics, softboard and chatbot, are finding very, you know, application in interactive answering the question without human. So people ask the question, and chatbot, based upon their background and their learning, they answer. Person cannot identify who is called, whether it is a machine or is a expert answering the question. These two concepts come from a very famous Turing machine, based upon the scientist Turing. They have actually made a test which can test the intelligence of a system. So chatbot and softbot are outcome of that. They imitate the intelligence of human, and nobody can find out most of the time whether it's a person answering or it's a computer expert computer is answering. Typically, if we can define AI into three buckets, some of the tasks under AI are expert tasks, some are formal, and other are mundane tasks from human point of view. You can say like speech, voice, vision, common sense, natural language, and all these things are very, very comes to natural to a human being. From birth, we know how to speak, how to observe, that's very common. But at the same time, with artificial intelligence, these topics which looked so mundane, so natural to human being, they are the most difficult and challenging topic in artificial intelligence. Although these other two level of task, formal and expert, they are not so challenging as it comes to artificial intelligence, because they are rule-based, ambiguity is not there, so they can be very well programmed, right? Whether it's the mathematics, whether it's a game playing chess, whether it's a theorem playing. Similarly, expert systems can be designed again for various sectors. Very common use is medical diagnostic, financial analysis, where they can predict how the market is going to behave, scientific analysis. Same goes to manufacturing and fault analysis. They can predict and also tell how to rectify, especially in engineering branches. So, as I was explaining, there's a difference how the intelligence is being used in machine versus human. For human, mundane tasks are easier to learn and they learn since their birth, but same is not true for the machine, as I already told. So we already discussed AI expert system is basically to solve the complex problem in a very narrow domain, right? Which is normally done by at a very extra level of expert of human intelligence. Typically, such systems are very high in performance. They are reliable. They are most understandable. They can advise, they can guide in human decision making. They can diagnose, they can explain things, they can predict. All these are typically quality exhibited by an AI-based expert system. So typically benefit of an AI expert system is availability. Once you make an AI system workable, then this can be typically reproduced at a mass level, which is very cost effective. Right? It can also deliver a speed. It can operate at a very less error rate. It can reduce risk because it can also work in an environment which is dangerous to human being. And steady response. They do not get tired because of less motivation or fatigue. So these are some of the advantages, you can say, of the expert system. They are being used across various domains, including design, medical domain, monitoring of the process system, and finance and commerce. These find very common use cases. So basically, if you can visualize an expert system is, first of all, is a human expert who tells the rule. Then there's a knowledge engineer who is basically trained how to put that his knowledge, human knowledge, into a format which computer can understand. Typically, this is called knowledge base. And then expert system has an inference engine. Based upon the rules and conditions, expert system can work out an answer using a user interface, then it advises to the human being, which can be another human being or it could be any other non-human being systems. So I already discussed machine learning is a way by which a computing system can gain knowledge by training by known inputs and output, and based upon that gained acquired learning, then it is being used to do a lot of useful tasks. It can predict, it can classify, it can cluster, all that. And machine learning comes in three flavors: supervised, unsupervised, and reinforced, as I already discussed just a few minutes back. Data mining is basically turn raw data into useful. It basically look for pattern in very large of data. Nowadays, this is very useful. We know the concept of big data. Big data is being generated by across various sensors, whether part of IoT, whether they are web or process industries, all these generate a lot of data. Business have a lot of data. All of them, they want to find out useful trend, useful patterns, so that can be used for optimizing their business, reducing the cost, understanding the consumer behaviors, right? Data mining comes in multiple flavors. They can be pictorial mining, text mining, media mining, web mining. All these are type of data which they mine, and henceforth they are named after type of data they are being used. The next useful contribution by AI is natural language understanding by the machine. For human being, natural language is very easy, but once it comes to making machines to understand natural language, it's a very, very, very challenging part of the AI. Typically, it can be input in natural language can be spoken, this is speech, or it could be written. Both can be then made understood by the technique called natural language understanding, by which the speech or the written text is analyzed, and then they, after analysis, they are stored in a databases, they are then compared, and then the natural language is generated. Generation is reverse. You have a written text inside the memory, then this program generates the either spoken words or written text. So this is reverse. So if we add step one or two, they have a wonderful combination. This can be used to provide an interface to the computers, not in any programming language. It can be in the natural language. I can speak to the machine and give instruction instead of giving a command through mouse or keyboard, which is typically used by a trained or skilled person. So AI provides very simple interface which make the use of computers very, very, very simple, even for the people who are not expert. The other advantage is it break the barrier of different language. I can speak to through computer in one language. It can translate my into a target language to another person I am speaking to. I can speak in India, and at the same time, if I am using inbuilt translator, it can translate my things and then convert into a person who is other side, maybe French or Germany, anything. So this is finding a very, very useful potential use case, which make communication among different skill varied people in terms of language, in terms of their skill level. And the underlying technology for to do this is a deep learning, which is called in AI neural networks, artificial neural networks. The concept actually came from the how human brain works. And as you know, human brain consists of a called neuron, which is a basic building block, which consists of, this is biological equivalent. This picture shows you it's an axon, which basically process input. Then we have the dendrite, which extract input. Then we have a information transfer. Similar concept has been mapped to a silicon and wires, right? Electronics consist of silicons and wires. So AI or artificial neural network have multiple layers, like human brain have multiple layers of neurons. Similarly, artificial neural network also have multiple layers. For just understanding the concept, I have taken a very simple diagram which have only three layers, input layer, and one of the hidden layers, and then we have the output layers. But in real life, there can be, you know, thousands of layers possible, but concept is extended in a similar way. So typically the neural network works on two ways, and accordingly they are classified: feed forward and feedback. As you know, there's an input layer, there's a hidden layer, then output layer. In feed forward, as the name suggests, the data flow from input layer to a hidden layer, then output layer. The other possibility also exists where it is driven from output layer. That means output is known, then backward it goes to a various intermediate layer and then go to input. So this is how it is designed. And there is another kind of two popular network which are being used: backpropagation and Bayesian network. Basically, backward propagation is when the input is learned from output, which I was talking feedback. The other is Bayesian. In Bayesian, basically, it deals with the probability. The input is not certain; they are uncertain. They have certain probability of happening. So this various neuron represent the probabilities of happening, and these type of network are very good to handle uncertain domain. A very good example of this is being into medical field, where they have been used to diagnose typical disease. Let's say lung cancer. Lung cancer typically happen because of couple of reasons, like this is through pollution or through smoking. So this particular neural network can be used to deduct what is the root cause. So neural network find its application in all such situations. And they have been found their use in aerospace, there where they can do autopilot of aircraft, they can detect faults in the aircraft. In automobiles, they can guide automotive self-driving cars. Military, they find application in weapon steering, enemy target detections, and threat assessment, facial recognition, all that. In electronic, chip design, layout, chip failure analysis, machine vision, all that, it is being even done for design of electronic system. In financial system, they are finding applications for loan appraisal, for mortgage screening, document creation, credit application, all that. In industrial, they found use in case of process control or quality inspections, machine maintenance, all that. Medical, already we discussed about it. So they find application across industries in telecom, transportation, even including softwares, signal processing, and anomaly detection or fault detection. They can be trained. One of the sub application of what you call deep learning is application for the machine vision. Okay, so machine vision basically automatically extract, analyze, comprehend useful information from single image or multiple images. Some of the typical applications which are currently available is image recognition of handwriting, or a face recognition, or monitoring video images, identifying some abnormal things happening, triggering these responses. Typically, any vision system comprises of some element. So first of all, there has to be some camera which captures the images. Then we have hardware accelerator which will convert the camera's image into a useful digital so that it can be processed by the software, which is basically nothing but any one of them, either neural network or any other appropriate learning algorithms. Okay, so this region make the systems more powerful. So application of vision are again across multiple sectors. It can be used in agriculture, biometrics, self-driving cars, character for sonic security surveillance, industrial, military, medical, imagery, robotics, you name it, it is available or useful in all kind of intelligent system. Without this vision, intelligent system are handicapped. Okay, the other useful AI branch is robotics, which all of us know. It is basically a domain in artificial intelligence, which deals with the intelligent and efficient robot. Basically, robots are artificial agent. When I say artificial, because they are not physical, but they operate in physical environment. They are artificial agent, but operating in real world environment. So they typically, they do manipulate the objects by perceiving. They can pick the object, they can move, they can modify the physical property of those by breaking or destroying, or they can move it, they can do the repetitive function once it is being trained to them, and they can do it 24 hours across all the times without getting bored, distracted or exhausted. They can also work in a situation where human being is almost difficult to do. In hazardous environment, they can do very well. So typically, robots have some mechanical structure in form or some form or shape, depending upon what task it has to do. It also have an electrical component, which makes the mechanical component to move or control a power. Then they also have computer programs in terms of which determine what, when, how to do it. This is where the AI come into picture. The AI part come into picture, the computer program. So the typical difference between normal AI and robotic is typically the AI program, which are non-robotic in nature, they operate in computer simulated environment. They take input to AI program in its symbol, and rules are simple. They need general purpose computer to operate on. They don't require special. While the robot, they operate in real physical world, which is unknown, which is noisy, which are distortion. Input to robot is an analog signal in form of speech, waveform, images, or anything else. They need a special hardware equipped with relevant sensors and factors. Now, software is a kind of robot totally in form of software. It is not a mechanical structure as we have seen the robot. So they quickly do a job which a human can do. And especially this software is very useful and come into trend from recent. They have been adopted by various business houses to do their, you know, routine tasks, like and software agent can scan the files coming from email, or they can scan the chats from the mobile apps or website, you know, and they can do even some value add to it. They can do it, if it is being rule based, they can probably look for some loan sanction application in financial sectors. So there's a whole new sub area which is being very popular nowadays, also known as RPA. Many of you must have heard robotic process automation. Although the name is coming robot, but it is no more a physical robot. This is a virtual robot in form of total software running on a cloud somewhere or in edges, which is not visible to the end users, but it does its jobs. Similarly, chatbot is a special case of softbot. It's useful in interactive question answers with the end users. End users can be a person. Person is answering some, looking for some questions. So it can be through website, it can be a mobile app, it can be telephone. So typically through this, people are asking question in natural language, right? And chat bot is trying to learn and then answer this in the natural language itself. So this is being used heavily in customer facing function. It is being used to automate call centers. It being used by various sites to what you call digital assistant or virtual assistant, which is available typically on all websites nowadays. Fuzzy logic, I already told in the beginning, it is basically a method of reasoning that very much resembles human reasoning. Human reasoning is involved not only the final output, they can use intermediate possibility, which typically computer don't deal with. Normal computer don't deal with, which we have so far discussing. Fuzzy logic is also an artificial system which handle intermediate step. Like normally, the common logic block in computers are binary, yes or no. But fuzzy based systems can handle in between. Like it can have a five state, certainly, yes, possibly, yes, cannot say, possible, no, certain, no. So it can handle in between as well. So this power of fuzzy logic is being deployed across various segments in consumer electronics as well as in industrials. A lot of home appliances, whether it's a washing machine, whether it's a microwave, they are being using fuzzy logic to control their access. Okay, this is the, you know, my first component of our talk, which is artificial intelligence. Now, the second component of our talk is Internet of Things. As the word says, Internet of Things describes basically a network of physical objects. Here, it is a network of physical objects, not the network of humans. Typical Internet, when it was designed, it was initially used, it was the network to communicate between the people. But now the Internet has been used to connect the machines. Especially consumer connected devices like TVs, smart speakers, toys, wearables, smart appliances. Similarly, if you go to enterprise class of device, so then we have smart meter, commercial security systems, smart city, including monitoring traffic, weather conditions. These are examples which find in industrial case. IoT, basically, if you talk about, have one very important, unique, it have the inbuilt interconnectivity, that too based on internet. And they can connect to other similar devices or to the other users. Other user could be the similar kind of other mechanical devices, or it can be even end user in as a human. Okay, so IoT have extended the potential of internet, and it has created a very potential source. And IoT, because it involves the sensors, it extend the reach of data. It capture a lot of data which can be analyzed. Lot of pattern can be inferred. And based upon that pattern, which is typically analyzed by artificial intelligence enabled programs, so which can make a very good combination. So IoT can be used where they are being, along with AI, they have been powered with AI, which can be used for voice user interface, data analytics, traffic management, 5G, edge computing, fleet management, self-driving vehicles. Nowadays, car can drive themselves. Although this is only in the lab situation, but very soon this could be cars running without driver on normal traffic conditions. Smart cities are using internet for everything, whether it's a smart metering, whether it's a smart light, parking management, or it is measuring pollutions. You name it, every aspect is being covered by IoT. They have the equipped sensor in with them. They have inbuilt in connectivity with the internet. They are connected to the backend system where data is being analyzed with the help of intelligent analytic system, which are powered by AI. And nowadays, the other trend is the IoT data need not to go across all the way to the back. The intelligence is being pushed back to the edge, and hence there's a trend called edge computing. The AI and things are being implemented not at the big cloud servers, but they are being used into the IoT device itself or somewhere in between. Could be an edge at the network, which could be gateways, so that is a thing which can happen. In fact, IoT is almost becoming augmented human. They are augmenting the capability of a normal human to do more works than as a standalone human can do. With the help of IoT, it has extended its capacity to do many tasks which is not possible alone by the human being. Let us come to the third building block. This is a blockchain. Actually, blockchain is not a very different altogether new technology. It's basically a combination of existing computers concept. Basically, if you combine two computer concept, it becomes a blockchain, as the name suggests. Block is nothing but a record of data. Data could be a transaction, financial transaction. It could be any other kind of information. And they are being stored through a chain, a network of chain, which is network is peer-to-peer node. Typically, that is different than client server. So this storage, which is a combination of these blocks connected to the chains, is also referred as digital ledger. What is the uniqueness about this? Every transaction in this ledger is authorized by a owner who start the transaction, which authenticate the transaction and safeguard it from tampering. Hence, it is very secure in nature. Then this ladder can be shared among many computers in network, which in turn record on the actual basis. Blockchain is capable of supporting various applications related to multiple industries like finance, supply chain, manufacturing, and obviously one of the first use case is cryptocurrency. So I'm not going to use it for my discussion for cryptocurrency. That's an independent topic itself. But my blockchain discussion is for non-cryptocurrency use cases. So basically, what are the advantages when I use blockchain-based system? It is highly secure with the help of digital signature, which make it fraud free. You cannot tamper, and by design itself, it is highly decentralized. Nobody is a central server in this scheme, all peer to peer. If one guy initiated transaction, other guys are using it, approving it, and also this have a inbuilt programming feature. This is called programmable contract. So it provides in between certain you can say triggerable points. When that particular condition is met, that automatic action can be initiated. So blockchain is highly secure, it is decentralized, and it have inbuilt capability to trigger automatic actions. So all these three capability make it suitable for using it in the systems being used for who are critical in nature, like which is for using in wherever there's a need of trust. So let's move to now how this combination of all these three make useful convergence. Actually, IoT, I told you, is a means to capture data from diverse sources and environment. But at the same time, this data cannot be used without using it, without processing it, so that it can be useful. So AI come into picture and it filter, it analyze the data collected by this and then help in support in decision making with or no human intervention. The combination of AI and IoT make this possible. While IoT deals with the device using the internet, AI makes the device learn from their data and experience. So these two features make it a very powerful potential. The convergence on IoT and IoT redefine the way the industry, business, and economy functions because of large data collection and intelligent inference. As it comes, at the core, IoT about sensors implanted into machines or the non-machine environment, collect the data and pass it through connectivity to the backend servers or to the edge, which typically process and extract the value. Then using this value, again IoT act onto it. Typically IoT have both, it have sensors, it have the actuators. So this is what is a combination which make artificial intelligence and IoT succeeds in achieving the all goals. So what it does typically, it boosts operational efficiency. AI in IoT crunch the data, manage learning from the data, predict operations, detect the abnormal parameters so that corrective action can be done. Then we can manage better risk with the help of AI, triggering new and enhanced product and service, which is a combination like cell-driven car, drone-operated services, unmanned vehicles. All these are new things. Eliminate costly things. This is how the powerful convergence works. Create sensors, then communicate through network, then aggregate, then analyze using intelligence, and then in comes the augmented behavior. This is the way how this whole chain of IoT and AI works together. So let's come to the last part of this, use cases. The use case I have categorized into various segments. The way we live, like a smart home, in a smart home you have intelligent climate control, smart light, other home appliances, security and safety. Also, once you move out, you have self-driving car, if not totally self-driving, but intelligent car, connected cars is a reality. If not the self-driving car, but the internet connected car is a reality. The second is learn, how we learn. Using AI, we can have what you call customized learning, personalized learning, using AR, VR, using virtual labs. Similarly, how we entertain, we can have our personalized playlist. The way we socialize, everybody knows social media, whether it's a WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter, all are ways which make customized. Health diagnostics, we have an expert system. We have a robotic surgery, we have a dust recovery. Similarly, in agriculture, we have a precision or a smart agriculture where drone can be used, where satellite imagery can be used to plan the crops, to protect the crops, and all various use cases. If we go to telecommunication, AI and IoT make them more efficient. Some concept like software-defined network, natural function virtualization, network slicing, enhancing customer experience. These are the use case comes from telecommunication. Similarly, conducting business using digital marketing, online shopping, all these are possibilities. If you go to industry, you have a concept called smart manufacturing, where you optimize your operations, reduce cost, increase your profit, avoid runtime. Similarly, it find application in finance where AML based trading you can use. You have online and mobile payment systems which are very common. Banking and online mobile, we have a smart city where mobility and transport, street parking, utilities are there, including e-governance. The special cases for military and wars where we can use to detect target, assess the threat, guide the weapons. Not only in military, even in inland security is also using for terrorist activity monitoring, disaster management and recovery, airborne space satellite, space launch vehicles, all are using the IoT and AI inbuilt into it. Now, towards the last part of my, some of the challenges being faced and way forward. AI is incredibly used, but at the same time, there is challenges. Challenges are in terms of threat to privacy. As you know, AI programs use our personal data, which can be misused, right? Threat to security, because nowadays IoT together with AI, they are being used in very, very mission critical or financial critical systems. So hence, if any security lapse, it's a big threat. Human dignity, because AI is almost imitating human behavior, so it is almost a threat to human existence and dignity. Threat to safety, because they are being used in safety critical system, any error can lead to a huge loss. So what is the way? Some of the problem we say, poisoning of data and corruption on model can happen. System are can be biases. Exclusion of digital device, because everybody cannot be use AI or data. Big company, big house are having, the other are not having. Like big brothers, small brothers. Google, Facebook, they typically control the data. In addition to this, there are ethical and legal problems. Who is going to have data, all that. Limitation of current system is, they are typically black box. They cannot explain how this result is happened. You cannot explain, and they just trust the result. So the way move forward, we need to design which can explain what is happening inside. Trust need to be restored by being transparent, by being unbiased, and they promote inclusion. They should be safe and secure. And futuristic system are going to be based on bio-inspired system, like how brain works, and then they are being translated into silicons. Okay, this was my.
Yeah, thank you very much for your, very detailed lecture covering all three emerging areas. That is AI. AI has been for a while, but also you expanded your talk into different areas of AI. Where all AI has been used, including chatbots, and then you extended it to blockchain, IoT. So it was a very detailed lecture. So thank you very much for the presentation.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, for giving me opportunity. Look forward to such more participation.
Yeah. Thank you so much.